morning, everyone. Good to see you all along. And we're very thankful for Glenn McBride for taking our service today when Jerry's away. And I'm sure you've all got these announcements on the way in. And if you haven't, you can take them on the way out, because there's a full page on the front and a full page on the back. So there's lots of announcements. So I'll just mention a couple here, because I'd be all day and give Glenn no time at all if I was to go through the whole sheet. So I suppose the main thing would be is that there's a committee meeting for First Ballybay Committee on Wednesday night in Dyer Valley Hall at 8 o'clock. And then there's the probably the next big highlight would be is the PW in Dyer Valley Hall on Thursday night at 8 o'clock. So there's loads of stuff. You've been reading for a half an hour. So just help yourselves to announcements if you already haven't got them. And we thank Glenn for coming, and we pray your blessing upon you and your wife here today. Thank you very much.
Victor, thank you very much for your kind welcome, and I want to thank your minister in his absence for having me along. Always a pleasure to come back to Ballybay to be with you folk, and what a joy it is today to gather to worship our great God together. As we come, we hear God's word. God calls us to come and worship. Psalm 117 reads that God tells us to praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love towards us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Well, let us come and let us worship God. Let us praise him together. We're going to do that first of all as we sing together. We're going to sing his word together from Psalm 103, verses 1 through to 18 of Psalm 103. And I ask you to stand and sing together to God's praise this great psalm about God and his love for us and his kindness towards us, even though we are sinners and don't deserve anything from him. Let's stand and sing praise to God. Thank you. sung God's praise together. We've thought about how He is merciful and kind and gracious. We're going to continue in worship as we turn to God in prayer now, as we adore Him, as we praise Him, and also as we now confess our sin to Him and ask for His forgiveness. Let's pray together. Our most loving God and gracious Heavenly Father, we gather here today to worship You because You have called us and commanded us to come and to praise Your great name. Lord, we bow down ourselves before You because as we come into Your presence, we are aware that we are but made of dust of the earth. Our lives are weak and as fleeting as the grass. Like flowers, we will soon be blown away by the wind. But You, Lord, are great and mighty, the everlasting and unchanging God. As God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, You are always to be praised, because Your love and Your faithfulness are great and never failing. Heavenly Father, we come to You because You have loved us first, and You have given Your Son for us, and with Him You have also given us Your Spirit, so that we may know Your love and bless Your name. Our merciful Father, as we come before You, we openly acknowledge that we are poor and miserable sinners. Lord, we have been conceived and born in sin. We are prone to do what is evil. By ourselves, we are incapable of doing anything good. In our sin, we endlessly break Your law. Lord, we deserve Your wrath and Your curse, both in this life and in the life that is to come. But we are sorry for our sin against You. We hate the fact that we have offended You and broke Your good law. Lord, forgive us especially because we have trusted in our own strength. We have worshipped ourselves instead of worshipping You. We have thought poorly about You instead of listening to Your word and praising You. Father, we even confess that in times past we have come to praise You and come to worship You, but it has only been with our lips. And as we've been singing, You have called us to praise You with all that is within us. Father, as we cry out for mercy, we pray that You would forgive us. Lord, we fear You and we love You. We trust You and we take You at Your word. So we pray that in Your great love, You would forgive us and turn our hearts back to You to walk in Your ways, Your good, pleasing, and perfect ways. Father, as we've been singing of Your love, we are amazed as we consider Your love for us. As high as heaven is above the earth, so great is Your love towards those who fear You. Father, we cannot comprehend the length and the width and the depth and the height of Your love. But Lord, from what we do know, we marvel and we pray that even today we would get a better sense by Your strength, by Your power working in us, we would get a better sense of how great Your love is for us. Father, we praise You that You sent Your only Son into the world for us, that we might live through Him. And Lord Jesus, we praise You because You came willingly into this world of sin. You came willingly and You took on our flesh. You knew weakness and pain and suffering. You bore our sin on the cross. And we praise You because You reign and rule over all, being the risen and ascended Lord. Lord, help us today as we seek to worship you. Help us by your Spirit and your Word to worship you well. And help us to live lives that are pleasing in your sight. Lord, we pray that you would be glorified here today as we worship you. And we pray also that you'd be glorified right throughout the nations where you are worshipped today as your church gathers in all places. Father, be with us and help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. We have come into God's presence and we have confessed our sin to him. And now for us to trust in the Lord Jesus, who have repented of our sin and love the Lord, God gives us assurance of our pardon. Those words from Psalm 103, verses 8 to 12 that we've already sung, are God's assurance of our forgiveness. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as east is from the west, so far doth he remove our transgressions from us. This is the hope and the assurance that we have in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we want to praise God for that. So we're going to sing again God's praise. Jesus loves me, this I know. Let's stand together and sing praise to God. Scripture reading just now. We're going to read from the New Testament later on, but first of all we're going to read from the Old Testament, from the book of Deuteronomy. If you have a copy of the scriptures, and I encourage you to open it up and to follow along with me as we hear God's word read. Reading from Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 1 through to 11. This is God's word. When the Lord your God brings you into the land that you are entering to take possession of it, and clears away many nations before you, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations more numerous and mightier than you. And when the Lord your God gives them over to you, and you defeat them, then you must devote them to complete destruction. You shall make no covenant with them and show no mercy to them. You shall not intermarry with them, giving your daughters to the sons or taking their daughters for your sons. For they would turn away your sons from following me and to serve other gods. Then the anger of the Lord would be kindled against you, and he would destroy you quickly. But thus you shall deal with them. You shall break down their altars and dash in pieces their pillars and chop down their asherim and burn their carved images with fire. For you are a people holy to the Lord, your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession. Out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth, it was not because you were more in number than any other that the Lord has set his love on you and chose you. For you were fewest of all peoples. But it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers, that the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know, therefore, that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations. And he repays to their faith those who hate him by destroying them. He will not be slack with the one who hates him. He will repay him to his face. You shall therefore be careful to do the commandments and the statutes and the rules that I command you today. And then we end our reading there, and we thank God for the reading of his word. Boys and girls, I want to invite you up to the front for a talk together, and I will come down there and meet you there. Boys, I want to talk to you first of all. The girls can listen in, but I want to talk to the boys first of all. I've got a question for you. It's a big question. Are there any girls that like you? Are there any girls that love you? Are there? How would you know if a girl liked you or loved you? How would you know? Well, I've brought something along with me this morning that you might find helpful. I can find it in my pocket. There's lots of things in my pocket, so I'll have to be careful to get the right thing. What have I brought along? It's a little bit torn up from being in my pocket, but what is it? Shout out if you can see, and you know what it is. Really small, but what is it? The girls can shout out to you if they know. It's a flower, it's a daisy, isn't it? And sometimes you see in the movies, if there's a boy and he's wondering if a girl loves him, he'll go and he'll find a daisy. And he'll look at the daisy and he'll say, "She loves me? She loves me not. She loves me? She loves me not." And he'll keep going around the daisy and see when it ends, which petal it ends on. And from that, and decide whether the girl loves him or not. I think that's a good idea. I think that works. No, it's probably not the best idea, but even if you don't do that, that's sometimes how we think. If you think about other people, you can think, okay, maybe they love me now, but later on, maybe they don't love me. Maybe they love me now, maybe they don't love me. Maybe they love me, maybe they don't. That's how we often think about people, because people change, don't they? Sometimes they love us, sometimes they don't. We're just after reading from the Bible, and we're going to read again in a few moments about God's love. We read there about how God loved his people. We're reading about the church in the Old Testament there, but God loved them. But it was quite interesting, because he said he didn't love them because they were the best. He didn't love them because they were the most numerous, the biggest people, the strongest people, the nicest people. God loved them because he loved them. He chose to love them and to make them his special people. That's great news for us. For us who love Jesus. It's great news for us, because when we think about God's love for us, sometimes we almost think of it as a deity, and we think, he loves me today, maybe tomorrow, maybe he doesn't love me. He loved me yesterday, maybe he doesn't love me anymore. Sometimes we think about that, we think about God like that. But that's not the way God is. God loves us, not because we're really good, or really strong, or really able to please him. He loves us even though we're sinners, and we're going to be thinking more as we read the Bible again about because God loved us, he sent his son to die in our place, to take the punishment that we deserve, so that we should never doubt God's love. We don't need to doubt his love. His love does not change like our love. His love is perfect. And we can be assured and be thankful that God loves us, and his love doesn't change. I'm going to pray for you, boys and girls, just now. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love. God, we thank you that you love us. Lord, we realize that we mess up, we sin, we do things that displease you. But Lord, your love does not change. You love us even better than we can understand. And Lord, we pray that you'd help each of the boys and girls to know your love more and more. Lord, help them to trust in Jesus, your Son, who you sent out of your love for them. And Lord, help us to, as we learn about your love, help us to show love also to others. Lord, help us as we continue to worship you now, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much, boys and girls. You can go back to your seat. And we're going to sing again. I can't quite remember the name of it. It's going to come up now. It was finished upon that cross. We're going to stand and sing together, and the collection will also be taken up during this hymn. So let's stand and sing to God's praise. It was finished upon the cross. Thank you. help as we come to his word again. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are light, and in you there is no darkness at all. So we look to you, and we pray that you would shine your light on us as we come to your word. Open our ears to hear your word. Soften our stubborn hearts to believe. Lord, turn our hearts from sin. Turn us to Christ, who is our only hope. Father, we pray that you would hear us and bless us, so that we would not just hear your word, but be doers of it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, if you have a Bible with you, please turn to the New Testament. We're going to read from the first letter of John, 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to the end of the chapter. 1 John 4, verse 7 to the end. I'm reading today from the ESV, the English Standard Version, primarily because there are a couple of words which I think the ESV does a good job of translating in this case, and we'll maybe say more about that as we go along. So let's read together God's Word from 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 to the end of the chapter. This is God's Word. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever abides in love abides in God and God in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. Because as he is, so also we are in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment. And whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him: whoever loves God must also love his brother. Amen. We thank God again for the reading of his word. It seems most probable that the most well-known fact about God is that God is love. I think if you spoke to your neighbors, or if you walked down Ballybay Street and spoke with someone and asked them what they knew about the God of the Bible, if they knew anything at all, they would probably, I'm guessing, say that God is love. While this may be the most well-known thing about God, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's well understood. Even both by those who love God and those who still hate him, we sometimes get mixed up and have wrong ideas when we think about God's love. This is primarily because love has different meanings depending who you ask. Especially nowadays, we're told that love has to approve of everything, has to encourage everything, has to be positive about everything. Love can't say no. There's a little phrase that we often hear today, love is love. Doesn't matter what it is, as long as it's called love, then it's love and it's good. And if we come with our modern understanding of love to the idea that God is love, then we will get mixed up in terms of what the Bible is actually saying. In this passage that we read from 1 John 4, verses 7 to 21, we learn more clearly about who God is. And we learn especially about how His love leads us to love others. We want to think, first of all, about that little phrase. It's repeated twice in verse 8 and verse 16. If you have a Bible, keep it open and read along with me. In verse 8 and verse 16, it's repeated that God is love. From verse 9 and 10, which comes after the first instance where we read God is love, we learn that here John is specifically referring to God the Father when he says God is love. We'll think more about this later on, but this is really important to even stop and consider that God is love. And particularly here we can think of the Father, that He is love. That's not often how, or not always as Christians, how Christians think about God the Father. We can get the idea that Jesus is the friendly one, the Son, He's the one who loves us. He has to twist the Father's arm to be nice to us. That's not the case. That's not what the Bible teaches. Here we learn that God the Father is love. He loved us so much that He sent His Son. The fact that Jesus came into the world is an expression of the Father's love. When we think about this statement that God is love, and when we think in our heads about what else the Bible teaches us about God, it's truly astonishing, even the statement that God is love. In Deuteronomy, we didn't read this passage together, but in Deuteronomy 33, verse 27, we learn that God is eternal. God is eternal. He doesn't have a beginning and He doesn't have an end. He's eternal. And therefore, when we think about that in light of what we read here in 1 John, we learn that God is love eternally. God is love eternally. He didn't begin to love. He will not end in love. He is love eternally. It's somewhat hard for us even to think about, but it's strange to think about that, because even before anything was created, even before God spoke the world into being, God is love eternally. How does that add up? How did God love before there was a world to love? Well, we get a glimpse into this real mystery in John 17. Jesus is praying to His Father in John 17, in verse 23 and 24. We get a glimpse in terms of what God's love looked like before the world began. Jesus prays to His Father there and speaks of the love which the Father loved the Son before the foundation of the world. Before anything was made, before anything happened, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit existed in true and perfect love. God is love eternally. Malachi, a prophet in the Old Testament, he tells us something more that's really important about God. He tells us, speaking for God to the people, and he says in Malachi 3, verse 6, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore you, O children of Jacob, are not consumed." That's in Malachi 3, 6. God says, "I do not change." God's love is like Himself. God's love does not change. It's not like our love, which comes and goes, which rises and falls. God's love is unchanging. God is perfectly unchanging in his love. Because this is who God is, we can then be called beloved. That's why one of the reasons why I read from the English Standard Version in verse 7 and in verse 11 as well, John refers to the people he's writing to as beloved. Not all translations translated that way. Some will translate it as friends or some other term in terms of just John is speaking to these people. But in the original, the idea is love, it's beloved. And of course, that's an old term that we may not use so much now. But I think it's quite wonderful when you think about God's love, God's great love, God's eternal love, God's unbreakable, unchangeable love. We, therefore, his people, we are called beloved. Beloved, loved by God's great love. As you think about this idea of God is love, we probably know that verse quite well. We've heard it before. And yet we often forget it. We often forget it, or at least we don't think about it enough. We misunderstand it. We can be guilty of having bad thoughts about God instead of thinking about his love. We think that maybe he used to love me, but he doesn't love me anymore. We think that maybe he loves me more now than he used to love me. Or we fall into that trap that I've already mentioned, that we think Jesus loves us, but he has to really convince the Father to love us. Those are all lies that we can be tempted to believe. Really dangerous lies about God and his love. God is love. And we should always remember this, because it brings us comfort and joy and assurance. It enables us to love him and to love others with the comfort of his love for us. I think this is a marvelous thing that we should think about far more often. We live in a cold and a harsh and a hostile and a lonely world. A lot of the time, it's not easy to live in this world as it is. Perfect example of this, maybe it's somewhat humorous, but the worst part of the year for me is the day that you have to renew your insurance. Maybe you enjoy that, I hate it. I hate having to renew car insurance or something like that. If it wasn't bad enough that you have to pay somebody a lump of money, if that wasn't bad enough, when you try to pay it, when you try to sort it out, you can't even talk to someone. You're told to go online, you're told to go into a website, you're told to email, you try to ring someone up and you put onto an answering machine and you're pressing buttons and you don't even know who you're talking to, and no one wants to talk to you, no one wants to know you. They want your money, they want that, but they don't want anything to do with you. In this sort of a world that we live in, we need to be reminded as Christians that God is love. He wants to hear us. He wants us to know him more. He wants to be with us. He loves us. He always has and he always will. As his people, this is the encouragement and strength that we need. God is love. And as we move on, we think particularly here about how God loved us first. God loved us first in verses 9 and 10 and verse 14 and again in verse 19. The emphasis is that God loved us first. We need to remember again who God is. Sometimes we think of God as just a bigger version of us. God is just, he's just stronger than us. He's just more powerful than us. He's like loads of us put together. We're like a small tree. He's like a big tree. That's sometimes how we think about God, but that's not true. God's totally different from us in that way. You know, you've got a little ant and a huge giraffe, and they don't seem to have much in common. But yet they have a lot in common compared to us and God. Because both of those have been created by God. Both of those have been created by God and are sustained by God and are on the earth to glorify God in their own way. But God is the creator and we are always creatures. And there's this great difference, this great distinction between us that we need to remember when we think about God. He's not just a bigger version of us. He's completely different in that way. And this is helpful when we think about God's love. God's love is not just stronger than ours. It's not just more powerful than ours. It's not just bigger than ours. God's love is first, and it loves us even when we're not lovely. That's what we read from Deuteronomy, that passage where God is speaking through Moses to his Old Testament church. And he tells them that he has chosen them. They're going to be his treasured possession. They're going to be his special people. But it's not because they're great. It's not because they're strong. It's not because they're good. It's because they're actually the weakest and the smallest. But he's going to love them because he's going to love them. He has chosen to love them. He's chosen to love them. And he has promised his love to them in covenant. John says the same thing when we come into the New Testament speaking to the church. In this, 1 John 4, verse 10, in this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. This is where our idea of love is different to God's. We love what is lovely. We love what looks good, what tastes good, what smells good, what feels good. But when we were still rebels, when we hated God, when we were foul with our sin and miserable, God loved us. He loved us first. He loved us first. None of this is to say that God's love means that he doesn't take our sins seriously. God does take our sins seriously. He has took our sin very seriously. Our sin angered God, and his wrath always burns against any sin, because he is pure, and he cannot stand that which is against his good and perfect being. And this is where we come to that big word in verse 10. Again, another reason why I read from the English Standard Version today. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Propitiation, what is that word about? Other translations don't carry that word through. They will use other words. But I think while propitiation is a big word and a difficult word, it's helpful and important here. And it's good at translating what the original Greek text says. Propitiation is the idea of turning aside wrath, turning away anger. And this is what Jesus has done. He was sent into the world. God loved us and sent Jesus into the world to turn away his wrath, to take God's curse for our sin. Our sin had to be dealt with. God loved us first, and he loved us so much that he provided himself the answer for our sin. This is just how great the Father's love is. That he would completely deal with our sin. That he himself would provide the solution for our mess. Jesus is the perfect Savior because he has bore God's wrath. He has took the punishment that we deserve. He has took it fully and finally. As we've been singing, it's finished on the cross. As we consider God's love, as we think about the length which he was willing to go for us, there's a real challenge here for for you if you don't believe in the Lord Jesus, if you don't believe in God's love for you, if you don't trust in Jesus as the Son of God and Savior of the world. There's a real challenge here because at the cross we see God's free and unchanging love. We see His free and unchanging love to sinners, and we also see how serious it takes sin. God couldn't brush sin under the carpet. He couldn't just forget about it. He couldn't move on and leave it as if it didn't matter. It really did matter. And so in His love, He took the punishment of our sin, and His Son bore it for us. If you're not a Christian, you need to realize that God's love is great. It's greater than your sin, but your sin is also serious, and you cannot keep it without consequence. It will cost you to give up sin. It always does. But the cost is greater to keep your sin and to confess it to God and turn from it. Verse 17 speaks of confidence. Verse 17, confidence which we have. We who know God's love and trust in Jesus, we have confidence in the face of the day of judgment. The day of judgment, without God's love, without Jesus Christ as Savior, is a fearful thing. But for us who love Jesus, who trust in the Father's love and turn from our sin, we have confidence even for the day of judgment, because Jesus is such a perfect Savior. And God's love is so strong for us. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, if you haven't trusted in Him, if you don't believe in God's love for you, then you really need to take this seriously. If you need to talk to your elders, if you need to talk to your minister, you need to find out more about this. You need to find out more about Jesus, who is the only Savior. You need to do that. God's love is great. And our only hope is that He loved us when we weren't lovable at all. Our only hope is that He loved us before we loved Him. Thirdly, and very briefly, we've thought about how God is love, about how He loved us first. And very briefly, we see that God's love changes us. God's love changes us. The Protestant reformer Martin Luther, he said many hundreds of years ago, he said, "The love of God does not find, but create that which is lovable." The love of God does not find, but it creates that which is lovable. It's a marvelous statement. Because God doesn't find something lovely in His love. That's not what His love is about. His love finds us in our sin. But He doesn't leave us there. In His love, He makes us lovable. And that's what John is really writing about here in the passage we read. About how we come to know God and His love. And we are enabled then to love God and to love others. Whoever loves God must also love his brother. If you say you love God but hate your brother, you're a liar, because how can you love God whom you have not seen and yet not love your brother whom you have seen? See, when we come to know of God's love, to love Him, then we are enabled and led to love others. This is how God works in us. He's given us His Spirit. We see in verse 13, He's given us His Son, first of all, to die for us. He gives us His Spirit to know His love and to enable us to love each other. It's a lot easier to say that we love God than it is to say we love our brothers and sisters in the church. And you'll say to me, "Well, you don't know what some of them are like. You don't know what some of them are like. Some of them are rascals. Some of them are very hard to love. Some of the people in the church and in other churches, they're hard to love." You're right, I don't know them. I don't know what they're like. But God does know, and He loves them. And more than that, He loves you. and once you were very unlovely too. As we think about God's love, we cannot help but love Him more and love the others too that He has loved. Love the people who are around you. Be with them here, week by week, as much as possible. Be with them. Love them. Be with them when it's hard for the people sitting around you, when they're going through hard times. Be there for them to love them. Continually be with them to remind them of God's great love. This is our great hope, our great confidence, our great truth that we cling to. And we continually need reminded of it. We love because God first loved us. Let's pray together. Father, we are amazed at your love. Lord, we realize again that we cannot comprehend the greatness of your love. Lord, we're especially amazed at the fact that you loved us when we weren't lovable. We're also thankful, Lord, that you don't find that which is lovely in us, but you create it. And so we pray for your continued work in our lives. May we love you more. And may we love our brothers and sisters in the church more and more. Father, as we thank you for all you've done for us, we pray for others today in need. We pray especially for those who, even right now, are caught up in the middle of war and conflict. Lord, we pray for those who struggle to even believe that love is such a thing. Father, we pray for men in this world who are set on evil and filled with hatred, who have caused wars and continue to inflict pain. Father, we pray that the rulers of this world would be able to silence evil men and bring their plans to nothing. Lord, we pray for those who are suffering in the ravages of war, especially in Ukraine right now, also in Yemen and also in Israel and Palestine. Lord, we think of those who are suffering, and Lord, we pray for the day when your love shall be known all throughout the world. And Lord, even sin will be judged and done away with. Father, as we pray for the world, we pray for the church, as you've called us to be a witness of your love, to be compelled by your love to go to others and to share your love with them. Father, we pray for the Presbyterian Church in Ireland, the denomination that we are so pleased to belong to. Lord, we pray for your continued grace and mercy, especially today, Lord, for congregations who don't have a minister, who are vacant. Lord, there are a great many of them. Father, we pray that you'd help our presbyteries as they think about what to do, facing the future, and it seems to be a big lack of ministers. Lord, give our elders and our ministers great wisdom. Guide them, O Lord, and may their decisions be good, and may you be pleased to bless us. Lord, we do look to you at this time, and we pray you'd be gracious to us. We pray you'd show us your mercy. Lord, you'd help us to turn from all our sin and to trust you and to love you and love your word. And Lord, that we would glorify and praise you. Father, we pray for these congregations here in Ballybay. Lord, we thank you for them. We thank you for their witness to the gospel. We pray especially for the Kirk Sessions, and we pray for the minister, Reverend Dr. Jerry Clinton, and we thank you for him. And we pray that you would continue to bless these congregations under him, as he feeds them with your word and nourishes them with the word of life. Lord, for those today here who are struggling and suffering, whether it be illness of body or mind, for others who are going through tough times and struggle to find hope, Lord, may you remind us again of your love. May you assure us of your love. Lord, may we be reminded that nothing in all creation can separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus. Father, hear our prayers. We offer them in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to respond to God's word and close our time of worship as we sing together, All I Want Held Dear. We stand as we praise God together. Him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever.